This podcast is being brought to you by Stamps.com. Never waste another minute of your life at the post office, I beg of you. Now with just your home computer and printer, Stamps.com can do it all. Also, we're brought to you today by GoDaddy.com. Yeah, simply the best for all your .com registration needs. The most known because they're the most trusted. GoDaddy.com. Hey, it's still summertime. Let's not forget, we're also sponsored today by the terrific folks at Mangrate.com, their amazing grill enhancement system. Now you can have steakhouse quality in your own backyard with Mangrate. Roll opening credits, please. Welcome back to yet another edition of Kevin Pollak's Chat Show. I am shockingly Chat Show.
I think we got an episode of Kevin Pollak's Hat Show today, I gotta be honest.
It is the Hat Show today. Where's yours?
It's a little bit of the Hat Show.
You still have a hair hat, you lucky son of a bitch.
I take this off when I go.
Enjoy it while it lasts, Sammy, is all I can tell you. I too once had a hairline, you son of a
bitch. I don't know.
I guess I still have a hairline, technically.
Yeah. Don't sell yourself short,
it's,
buddy.
It's gone north. It's gone north.
I have a proceeding hairline.
Aha! Yeah, you do.
I'm in trouble.
You do. You got that You got that Eddie Munster thing.
I do.
Yeah, a little bit.
No.
I've missed you so. We had 2 weeks off. We were only supposed to have 1 week off as I went off to start the World Series of Poker main event in the Las Vegas. So we were supposed to miss the 8th of July. And then I stayed too long. Yeah. I stayed too long, and so we missed last week, the 15th. Matt Walsh has been rescheduled.
But, Kevin, why did you stay too long?
Why are you asking me that?
I'm just curious.
Oh, that's right. I competed in the main event of the World Series of Poker for the first time. I'd like to thank HollywoodPoker.com for being my partner in this endeavor. So you go there, and it's day one. There's 6,598 players who all paid $10,000 apiece to be there, or they won the $10,000 seat in a charity tournament or what have you. But that's a lot of people paying 10 grand. HollywoodPoker.com, of course, writing this particular check. God bless them. So I went there really to survive day one. I'm the new ambassador for Hollywood Poker, do a little schmoozing. Jennifer Tilly's there, Jason Alexander, Ray Romano, some other peeps. And everyone starts with the same chip count, and then if you play really tight and conservative and avoid bad luck, you make it to another day, which is what happened to me. And then day two became day three became day four, and on to day five, yeah, it kept going and going and going. And ESPN, there's the listing at WSOP's site. Where did I finish? Way down there. Remember, 6,598 players. Who finished 134? Why, it's me, Kevin Pollak. Yeah, 134 out of 6,598. So 98% of the field, and now I'm listed as I'm listed on the winnings chart.
Wow.
Yeah, when you cash in a tournament, why would you zoom in on that? We zoomed in on my winnings, 52,718, a number I shan't forget anytime soon.
Boy, the government sure do take a bite, don't she?
Yeah, the government do take a bite. I got lots of expenses, though. Oh, man, do I have expenses.
You do.
I have expenses up the wazooie.
Yeah. I don't know why you kept taking that $10,000 an hour limo from casino to casino.
Well, I tip. So it was my first time at the main event. We talked, I think, a couple weeks ago when we were here about Sammy doing so great at the Kansas City Big Slick tournament that Rob Riggle, Jason Sudeikis, and Paul Rudd put together.
Mm-hmm. Not to out to your eye, I won $500,000 in that.
You
it
did.
Was for charity, so not a big deal.
But the guy who won that tournament finished 78th or 5th.
So somewhere in the 70s.
Yeah.
Yeah.
They're putting up the quote, "I hate tournaments, Kevin Pollak."
It's true.
Because I've been saying it my whole life.
Did anyone give you any sort of coaching before you played?
Before I went to do the tournament, I asked our very own Sam Levine, any insights?
Oh.
Being a big tournament finalist, his own damn self. And he said, yeah, I got nothing for you.
I don't remember it happening that way.
How do you remember it?
I remember me sitting down in that chair where our guest is sitting at this very moment, and are they coming? and giving you what I thought was pretty sound advice for a guy who hates tournaments.
And what was that advice again?
Really?
Let's pass it along to
I'm
everyone.
Not giving it out to everybody. Oh. This is good advice.
Okay. I thought maybe if you gave it to somebody else, they might actually pay you for it.
No, I'll never get money for this. Not until I write a book, which, man, everyone wants somebody to write a poker book.
Yeah.
If only someone would put that down in book form.
If only. Thanks to HollywoodPoker.com for making this incredible, exhausting ride possible. I was stuck there in Vegas for 9 days, which I do not recommend. Hoy. But what an exhilarating, exhausting, ridiculous experience. I'm at the feature table a couple times, which is where they do the final nine players. On the main stage, they got the cameras embedded in the table, so you show your cards, that whole thing. And there at the main stage, at the feature table, under the hot lights and cameras, I knocked out one of the top 10 players in the world, Daniel Negreanu.
Spoiler alert!
Spoiler alert, yeah. Before the ESPN coverage, which will be all through September and October. But it was already on the interwebs. Plus, I kind of tweeted the shit out of it. So, it's been spoiled.
All right.
So, the whole experience was just ridiculous. And I look forward to you guys giving me some feedback on the ESPN coverage that'll start. Oh, you know what? I'm wrong. August 14th or 15th is when the ESPN coverage. Someone just corrected me, and I just remember that. Sammy?
Yeah, buddy?
You had a couple of weeks off. What the hell?
I was in New York. It was great.
And?
City's still there, so.
Tell us all the great theater you saw, because we know how you love to go
you
see the...
You know, I mean, you can't have a conversation with me without me talking about the musicals that I've been to recently mm-hmm. and how much I love them all.
Okay.
Or you must be thinking of someone else.
That's right, I am.
I'll see a good straight play, like The Beheading of Spokane.
Uh-huh. Or The Behanding.
No,
Behanding.
I know.
What about the producers at the Hollywood Bowl with our own Richard Kind?
Oh, are they still showing it?
It's coming in August.
Oh, rats.
You know who's doing it with him? Wait for it. Dane Cook.
I don't believe
it. Let's go to commercial. Yeah.
Is that accurate?
That's an accurate pairing and teaming, as it was meant to be, I believe, originally written.
See, this is I had a buddy cop movie that I wanted Richard Kind and Dane Cook for.
Right.
And I feel like now people are going to be like, we've already seen that.
That's what they're going to do.
That's what they're going
to say. Jamie, you'll go to see it though, right?
No. I don't like the Hollywood Bowl.
Yeah, tell us why.
It's a hassle. And it's everywhere. It's
the parking? Everywhere.
The parking, the
people?
Walking, the people, everything.
The people.
Everything.
Right.
I don't know. I'm a curmudgeon. I'll go to Disneyland every freaking week.
And deal with the parking and the people.
Deal with all
How
that.
Are you going to tell Richard?
Yeah, we miss him. We probably do have to go to support Richard.
Yeah. Well, maybe we'll see him when he's here. Did you enjoy your 2 weeks? You've got, oh, look. There's Dane Cook, the announcement right there. They put it up on the screen. Oh, thank God he's wearing a tank top for the press photo. Otherwise, I wouldn't know it was the producers.
Gene Wilder?
Yeah.
Dane Cook.
Sure.
I don't, this is...
Matthew Broderick, Dane Cook, also in the same...
You know what, I'll save my prejudgments until I read about it in Variety.
There you go. And you, 2 weeks off, what happened? You have family, friends in town.
Yes, I do. My best friend is in town visiting this weekend.
And they've been great to have.
Yeah, it's been nice to have them around.
Yeah.
I haven't seen her in a while.
In downtown last night.
Yes.
With the Dr. Chen.
Yes. Yeah, I got Kenny Chen to come out.
Did he play the trombone?
Yeah, you just all Kenny Chen jumbone. We went and saw a lovely show on Thursday with Nick Kroll. Love him.
Also past guest.
Yeah, he's past guest.
And he did the 1970s Eater.
He did the 70s Eater, which I love.
Which he's filmed apparently for his show, so everyone can look forward to seeing 1970s Eater. Or just 70s Eater.
70s Eater in a movie.
Yeah, yes. It's specifically how they eater. Ate food in right.
movies. In the 70s.
In the 70s, but really it's Saturday Night Fever, isn't it?
Yes, he's really doing Saturday Night Fever.
I get some coffee.
Sugar.
Get some sugar for the.
I love him.
Like a maniac.
He did this great bit about insisting that the founding fathers were all on cocaine.
Oh, God. We were on the floor.
I love him. He's
the founding
so funny.
Fathers on cocaine. Nick Kroll's new show comes in January. Look for that.
2017, he said. January 2017.
Yeah, he kept giving him shit because they kept putting it off. So, also, those of you who enjoy the poker, I should mention about the HollywoodPoker.com. You're going to hear more about this, I'll tell you, in the coming weeks to months. It's a play-for-free site that's relaunching in September. You'll have a chance to play like you do on the Zynga with the Facebook. Only here you'll be playing with celebrities on occasion, which will be kind of fun. I'll tell you more about that, some tournaments and some charity events. Thanks for joining us on the talk and walking. Fall way behind. I'm going to have to get Sam Levine over the house to do another one.
What?
For the Sweet Does. We ask you to write to us at Kevin Pollack, contact at kevinpollackchatshow.com. We have a couple Ask Kevins. Let's go to the first one now. First, run the graphic.
Ask Kevin.
Hey, look at that. Never get tired of that. Or do I? This one's from Greg in OC. Can't understand a single syllable in that end theme song of yours. I bet it's funny. Sound like it could be funny. It probably is funny. Wouldn't know. Can't understand a goddamn word of it. Yet another case of someone doing something like that, trying to be cool and oh so witty and forgetting the first basic rule of stuff like this. Make the damn thing intelligible. Should be at the top of the list, perhaps. Got the lyrics so I can read along, Kevin? Okay, Greg and OC, thanks for writing.
Do you know what our, we never should have had Bane from The Dark Knight Rises sing the end theme song. That's topical humor, Kevin.
That's topical humor.
That's topical.
Those of you who have seen the movie to the tune of 160 million know exactly what Sammy's talking about. I'm going to guess because of the
it's a little hard to hear
sleep
what
apnea?
Yes, his sleep apnea mask that he wears during the day makes it a little hard for people to understand what he is saying.
Yeah. Well, I guess from the previous Batman, they said, you know, now the Batman is talking like this. Mm-hmm. We better get the guy who you can't hear at all.
Right.
So, Greg and OC, my response to your question is, as everyone is expecting from me now, go fuck yourself. Seriously. First of all, it's no longer the outro music. So, try to keep up. Go to the archives, kevinpollackchatshow.com/archive. Yeah, well, though it's no longer backslash, it's just slash, right? There's no forward back. Archive, look up any of the episodes where that is the outro or the intro. Slow it on down, listen to the lyrics yourself. If you pay attention, you dumb fuck, you'll be able to hear the lyrics. Too harsh? Too much? I ask people to write in and then I yell at them? It seems like a weird tradition. All right. This next one is from Joseph Lake. Hello, Kevin, Sam, and Jamie, assuming no one is on vacation. I found your show on Hulu and immediately loved it. My girlfriend and friends are all very annoyed by me telling them about this really funny story I heard on the chat show the other day. Annoyance, of course, being due to the fact that I am ruining endings and mixing up key facts in these stories. Anyway, I also recently saw you in the sci-fi miniseries The Lost Room. You're an amazing bad guy, which got me thinking, if a movie was to be remade, or a story from another entertainment type, comics, novels, theater, made into a movie, what villain would you want to... What villain would you want to portray in this movie? If there isn't a particular villain... Oh my God, there's more. What villain archetype would you want to portray? That's from...
Doesn't matter.
Was there a character in fiction at some point that I'd want to portray in a movie?
Yeah.
Sure.
Moriarty. There you go. You're welcome.
Thank you.
See you next year.
Thank you. Any villain throughout history?
Genghis Khan.
No, I was thinking...
Dwight.
Dastardly.
Dick Dastardly?
Dick Dastardly.
The cartoon?
Yes.
The movie of the Hanna-Barbera?
Or Dishonest John from Beanie and Cecil. Dishonest John. There you go. Dishonest John. And now this last one from TJ Stone. Hey, Kevin. Do you know if Jamie has Simpsons World, a complete episode guide to the first 20 seasons of The Simpsons? I just got it for my birthday present, and she would love it as a fan of the show. It's basically a ginormous Simpsons encyclopedia with a glossary and everything. Jamal, everyone that watches this show or listens knows that you're a fan of The Simpsons. And so the question, how do you respond?
Of course I own it, but I don't need it because the encyclopedia is right up here.
In fact, recently a discovery was made that it may be some form of Tourette's for you.
Yes, my friend says it is my nervous tic. Whenever I am in a comfortable situation, I just start quoting Simpsons.
Yeah.
To make everyone feel comfortable.
So you could have written this encyclopedia.
Possibly.
Truth be told.
But it's nice, though, because between guests on the chat show, I've had people sign it. So I've had, like, James L. Brooks sign it, and I've had Harry Shearer sign it. I had Harry Shearer sign it on the See My Vest.
Oh, nice.
The lyrics.
The Mr. Burns.
Mr. Burns.
And I guess apparently Hank refuses to sign it.
I'm sorry?
Hank Azaria.
I just don't think he's, like, been to the house recently for him to sign it.
Ah, all right. Well, he's back from doing the Gargamel or whatever that character is.
Mm-hmm. It's Gargamel. You're correct.
Oh, God. I can't believe I got it right for a change. All right. So write to us if you would at AskKevin at contact@kevinpollockchatshow.com or your Larry King game if you want to win a T-shirt, the Kevin Pollock Chat Show T-shirt, which our guest today will be leaving and then quickly giving to his housekeeper. Most likely. Do we have a Larry King game? Nope. Why would we? Weird. All right. Well, we'll ask our guest to provide one at the end of the show, much to his surprise and dismay. Thanks for subscribing to us on iTunes if you would. Thanks to write a review if you get a second. God damn it. My guest today, I believe that's it for the new business.
It better be.
My guest today, I'm extremely excited. We've booked another guest through Twitter. Who knew? We met years and years ago. I'm going to ask him if he remembers. I barely do, and we're both of leaky memories at this age. But big sort of instant fan. I've mentioned many times on this show my collecting character actors from childhood, the way my friends collected baseball cards. And even in the movies as a 5-6-year-old, I would come out of the theater mesmerized and often impersonating one of the character actors. And incredibly delightful to my mother for an hour or two.
You still do this?
Yeah, not so much for 2 weeks. I still do.
You still do this? All right. You still come out of the movie theater, and if like somebody has a British accent, it's like I get British accent for the rest of the weekend.
Not intentionally. It's a Zelig problem. I can't help it. And today's guest hit me in the same way, and I'm thrilled beyond belief having J-Mac do the 35-page dossier to have a better chance to get to know him. Please welcome Mr. Richard Schiff to our fine table of joy. Welcome back from,
there's an upper deck.
That was nice.
That was very sweet, your introduction, by the way.
Oh, please. Am I incorrect that you were recently in London yet again?
Yes.
When we were communicating. When we were communicating about you coming
to the
show.
I was in England.
Right.
And I was in Sheffield. They asked me to be. I work a lot in London, which I love to do. And I was asked to be a judge at an international drama festival. So I took my son.
Oh boy!
Which was great.
Yeah.
And after doing a little film in New York, we went to London, and then he's 17. But no one really cares if you have a Guinness or six when you're 17.
Is that right?
So I got him his first. Piss, as they say in London. I got him a Guinness. We went to this Chelsea Arts Club with a guy who's a very prominent man in London. He's the editor and publisher or former of The Independent, and he became a very good friend of mine when I was working there once, and I've written articles for them as a result. But they took us to the Chelsea Art Club with his wife, Sally Ann, mm-hmm. and a BBC reporter and a guy from the SAS joined us, and my son's over there. Go ahead, get a Guinness. And I literally got interested in this conversation with the SAS guy, wondering what's going on in Afghanistan. And I turn around, the beer goes down, have two sentences, turn around, and the Guinness is gone. So I said, Gus, there's such a thing as taking two sips on a beer before it's finished. So he ended up having like three or four and tilted his way home.
How did that work out?
It was fun being there for your son's first drunk.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? As opposed to he comes home with vomit on his shirt later on, you know. Yeah. I was actually there for it and could be responsible,
sending him on his way, as it were?
I could be prosecuted for it, in fact. sending him on his way. But we have a theory with our kids, which is everything in front of us and blah, 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 not everything, but you know what I mean?
Sure.
So he's actually kind of shy about it, and he just enjoys it because he's half Irish. And it was fine, and the next night he didn't want one because he didn't really like the hangover. So we ended up in Sheffield, and we just had a great time, International Student Drama Festival there, seeing shows from all over the world,
right.
Palestine and Israel together, and Zimbabwe and Georgia, this great production of Our Town from Georgia. They were phenomenal. So we had a great time. Then St. Andrews, where I wanted my son to go to college in a year, which if he goes to St. Andrews, and I commute there once a month and say take a couple of rounds at the golf course, the old course.
The old course.
All in, including my commutes and my MIT fee, mm-hmm. it's cheaper than Stanford. Just want to say.
Is that right?
Yes.
Wow.
And it's actually a great school. And then we met my wife and daughter in Ireland, and we spent 12 days tooling around Ireland, where she met relatives she's never met before, which was fantastic.
That must have been remarkable.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
What was the question?
We don't have questions here.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, we meander.
It was fantastic. It was
you,
great trip.
But working a lot in London, I couldn't be more envious of that. It is my favorite city in the world.
Is it?
Yep.
For good reason, I think.
Yeah. I've been dozens of times.
First of all, the women are drunk by 8 o'clock.
Never worked that. Really?
I mean, you know, how can you beat that?
You can't.
You can't.
I don't think you can.
No, it's a great town.
Yeah. And, you know, because of the accent, it's a perfectly charming New York.
Yeah.
You know? I love how the cabbies have to be historians also.
Well, I played a cabbie, actually, a London cabbie, who happened to be American in the movie Infidel.
Right.
With Omid Jalili, who's a stand-up comic who you might know, is really great. And David Baddiel, who's like the Woody Allen of England, mm-hmm. a younger version, wrote it. But I hung out with cab drivers for quite a while. You know, it takes them 3 years
right.
to get the knowledge,
apprentice.
Which is, yeah. Well, they bike around and they literally memorize the city.
Right.
And yes, they are historians as well. And it's really like getting a PhD in London
yeah.
to become a cabbie. The New York, I drove a cab in New York, which I'm guessing you might have as well. Did you?
No, but I know this about you.
And the test, okay, it's 3 years to pass the test in London.
Right.
And probably a 12-hour exam. You know what the test was in New York when
Please
I
tell
got
us.
My hack license? It was 10 questions, which were passed out in the room that you were waiting in to before you took the test. So everybody got the answers. But it's 10 questions consisting of where is Madison Square Garden, where is Yankee Stadium, where's Shea Stadium? Where's Roosevelt Hospital? Where's Cabrini Boulevard Hospital? Which was a trick question, because it was on Cabrini Boulevard. Where was JFK Airport? Because everyone, when they get in the cab, gives you the address of the airport as opposed to the...
That's right.
You know, 10 questions, which is why New York is infamous for cab drivers who don't speak English, who are just off the boat, and who know where Madison Square Garden is, so they get the hack license.
Right.
Yeah.
You were driving a cab while starting a theater career, first as a director.
Yes.
So I am very curious about the, how does one start as a director? The choice of that, we may find that you were sort of putting off the reality check of what you'd rather do.
Is that your analysis?
It's my awful 101. I'm assuming there's some, I know there's theater background for you in New York City College, I think.
City College of New York,
New York, right.
That's where I kind of backdoored my way into the
right.
theater program. It just so happened that they had a theater program there that was phenomenal. Earl Gister had come from Carnegie Mellon before he went on to the Yale School of Drama, and he brought all these Juilliard people up. And they already had, you know, the teachers at City College at the time were all, if they're in the arts or if they're in the English field, even the history field, were all quite impressive professionals, and this was their way to supplement their lives. Mm. So, like, I first was studying history there, and we had, you know, a guy named Dante Puzo, who actually fought in the Spanish Civil War. You know what I mean? They were all lefties from the 50s, and in the McCarthy era, that was a haven for lefties up at City College, you know. So Joseph Heller taught there, Kurt Vonnegut taught there. It was called the Harvard of the Proletariat. It was free. And all of the people that built New York came through City College, including 3 or 4 mayors and 11 Nobel laureates and so on. So it was a play, and the theater program had people like a guy named Robert Macbeth, which I always thought was cool, and an acting teacher.
Bobby Macbeth?
Was named. No, he was very tall. He was an African-American gentleman. with a full gray beard who played basketball for Kansas. And he was quite a guy. But he had founded the New Lafayette Theater in Harlem. We had Rhea Geisner, who was with the Open Theater, where Joe Chaykin and Sam Shepard was. And so we had these amazing, the Herman Shumlin. Herman Shumlin was about 96 years old when I went to his class. He was a little bald guy, like a cue ball, but with big bulging eyes, one of the most intense human beings I ever met. He had
96?
I might be exaggerating. It might have been 93.
Okay.
He had directed the original Inherit the Wind with Paul Muni.
Jesus.
He directed and produced the original Grand Hotel. He directed all of Lillian Hellman's plays on Broadway originally.
And you're learning from this guy.
Yeah. And so so I just backdoored my way in. I dropped out of college, went to Colorado, found some free love stuff, and came back and...
Cut some wood.
Yeah, because I did.
Mm-hmm.
You knew that.
Uh-huh.
I did log firewood
uh-huh.
illegally up in the mountains.
Sure.
For $10 a day. And just backdoored my way in. I just took an acting class and found that, you know, wow, there were girls in these classes and you rehearse and stuff, and that was cool. And then I was asked to audition for this program, and it was a professional training actors program. And Earl Gister, who became a mentor, he just passed just this last year. I remember auditioning. I loved movies, probably not to the degree that you did, but I went to some plays. My parents were kind of, you know,
sure.
a little bit to theater. But mostly these movies, and I would be very moved by them and be very curious about how that happened.
Right.
So I'd see somebody in a movie and be blown away by it and get into this trance, you know, that you just stay in for hours. I would not yes. want to talk to anybody. I just want to stay in that trance.
I do know the trance.
Yeah. And then I'd be curious because the same people I'd seen in another movie, and the trance never happened. So I just kind of became curious about it. And so I was asked to audition for this, and I kind of went, I mean, I was lost, so I went, okay. And a friend of mine who was my roommate was just this theater freak, but didn't want to go into it. He was a basketball guy and a tennis player, but he just loved theater. And I said, I was asked to audition. I don't know what to do. He goes, he gave me Little Murders. And I read that, Murray Schiskel, right?
Okay.
And I read that thing as funny. And I started reading this thing, and Earl and the other guy, Al Shermley, who were the director of the program, whenever they laughed, I would look up and like, you know, what are you doing? I'm trying to read. And I would read again, and they'd laugh again, and I'd look up, and I just didn't understand it. So when I was done, Earl Gister says, why are you so nervous? And I said, well, I've never done this before. And he said, well, why are you auditioning? Do you want to be an actor? And I said, no. And he said, well, why are you here? I said, I don't know.
Perfect.
He said, well, what are you going to do with this program? I said, well, I write a little bit, so maybe. I was so lost in the world at that point.
Sure.
So, I mean, I was just being honest. And 2 years later, we used to sit and talk and smoke cigarettes and drink tubs of coffee in his office. And he was fascinating and really brilliant guy. And at one point, I said, why did you let me into this program? You got kids from Performing Arts High School and all these people that walk around in tights, you know.
And give a shit.
And, you know, and he said, because in all my years of doing this, and he was the president of the League of Professional Training Schools all across the country, and so he obviously a lot of experience with all this. Because all the years I've been doing this, I never had anyone so honest in the interview. I said, so I've been using this honesty thing in Hollywood. It doesn't work.
No, it doesn't.
It doesn't work here.
It doesn't work.
I can't.
It
my first
apply.
Experience.
In fact, the opposite is true.
The opposite
it's
is absolutely
true. It's the old, do you ride horseback? I got a saddle in the trunk.
Exactly right.
Yeah.
So, what was the question?
I didn't get into directing.
The directing thing. So I did this acting thing, and I really hated it. Honestly, I just, I was fascinated by it.
It didn't feel natural? What part did you hate?
Nothing was natural. No, I was terror. It was a mountain, an Everest of fear every time I was asked to do an exercise.
So you did not suffer, as many of us do at an early age, from hey, look at me disease?
Oh, my God. I envy that. I really do. I love the people who go on stage, even if they don't have anything to do.
That's right.
And it reminds me of kids. They see a dinner table full of guests from their parents, and they come out and they decide they're doing a show. They just haven't figured anything out yet.
There's no script.
They can't sing.
There's no point.
I kind of really envy that. I don't have that. In fact, I hide, and I'll, you know. I'm embarrassed by it.
Well, that's why my 101 was suggesting that water, sir?
No, I have to cough.
Okay. There was the suppressed interest to give it a go. So that's why I'm happy to find out that it was more a case of, as you just described it, of abject fear.
Well, I did get over it a little bit in college, but the shell never came off of me.
And so then, did he suggest you try the directing?
No, there was a couple of breakthroughs in the class where he let me know that there was something there, where I just kind of forgot I was scared. Right. And it's a very good lesson to learn because you remember why it was, because you're so
present,
kind of focused, you know, in what you're doing, that you forget that you don't want to be up here. But I did go on an audition. I had a girlfriend who was an actor, and her mother had come from London, who was another interesting story, but I'll stay on the track. Ask me about her later if you want.
The girlfriend from London?
The mother from London,
okay.
Yeah. But she went out on an audition and got a part in this play, Blues for Mr. Charlie by James Baldwin, which we had done in college with the wonderful Israel Hicks directing.
Wow.
And I played Parnell, who was one of the white town leads. And then I went to audition in Brooklyn, the Masonic Temple in Fort Hamilton, for a paying job. It was actually, my first audition was for a paying job. And I knew the play inside and out, which was another great lesson, because I knew so much of it that I had no questions in my head when I went and auditioned. And I auditioned for a small role, and they said, why don't you audition for this? So I ended up getting the lead, the murderer. It's based on the Emmett Till case, the first white man ever to be brought to trial for killing a black man, in this case a kid, in Mississippi in 1954. The play, originally 1959, Rip Torn played the part that I was playing. And it was quite a phenomenal experience, and it went very well. And everybody asked me to join their companies and so on. But as wonderful as it was on stage, every day I had to get to Brooklyn at noon to begin my warm-up for the 8 o'clock show because I had so much terror.
Literally?
I'm not kidding. I mean, now it's better. It's 2 or 3 o'clock. I mean, I'm experienced now. So
So is it a matter of convincing yourself to go out there in front of the audience?
No, it doesn't have anything to do with the audience, or maybe it does, and I'm lying.
Well, they're live, and they're sitting there, and they're watching. They're staring at you.
Yeah. Well, the long evolution of it, it got to the point where when I was in London, I was doing a one-man play.
Something about lentils.
Underneath the Lintel. It was a beautiful play by Glenn Berger, who co-wrote Spider-Man, the play, which I haven't seen. But I was doing that play, which I had done on the East Coast, and then brought it to London, and had a rough press night.
And by the East Coast, of course, you mean Brunswick, New Jersey.
New Brunswick.
That's right.
Newer version of Brunswick. Right. Yeah, at the George Street Playhouse.
Right.
They had asked me to do this play in the last season in the West Wing, and everyone said, "Why on earth would you go to New Jersey to do a one-man show?" So I thought that was a good reason to do it. But plus, the play was very, very moving to me. So it was a curiosity. It was like, how do I solve the problems of this play? And then in London, everybody talks about press night. We don't have this in America. We just have opening night. And on Broadway, the critics come before opening night.
Right.
There were 180 critics in the theater, and I had a day off the day before. And it wasn't a great experience.
For press night.
Yeah, it was like a little bit of a choke. And still, I guess the work was good enough, so we got great reviews, most of them, and we still did very well. But I felt really bad. And that low point kind of bounced me back up. And 2 weeks later, I started to find stuff on stage that I didn't know existed before. And it became a phenomenal experience. It's too long a story to go through the steps of it, but it had to do with messing up.
Right. And realizing that nothing horrible was going to happen.
Yeah, I mean, it's really just realizing that when you mess up, you become more present than you were the second before. Because part of the reason why you messed up is because you weren't really as present as you maybe want to be. And when you kick into, like, the danger zone of, wow, how the hell am I going to get out of this one?
Yeah.
Which I did. There was one night.
Couldn't be more present than that.
Couldn't be more present. I had to start improvising in meter. You know, I had skipped 12 pages of the play.
Sure.
And I had to go back, because it makes no sense, obviously. If, you know, you skip the part where you meet Juliet, you know, it kind of doesn't make sense.
Who's the girl?
Who's the girl, and why is he, like, dying for her?
Right.
So, anyways, that being that present just kicked something in for me.
Right.
And I turned upstage going, what the fuck am I going to get out of this? But I had a big smile on my face. And without even thinking about it, I realized this is going to be fucking fun.
Yeah.
And it was. It was a blast. And then afterwards, it was a Q&A and everybody knew about it, but we all just laughed about it because it was fun to see how we were all going to get out of this together. That being in that presence started connecting me to the audience even more. And then I suddenly realized that's falling off the cliff.
Yeah.
Basically. So then I asked myself, why don't I jump off the cliff from the first moment?
Yeah.
I mean, why am I...
Why am I so fucking afraid of the cliff?
Why am I, you know... Yeah.
When that's the only time I had fun.
Right. When you had more... I mean, being alive is really what it's all about and what we do, I think. And, you know, in life, and some people are alive all the time because they're mercenaries or they jump out of airplanes. I don't want to do that, so... I find other ways, you know, and this is one of them. Mm. And so why back away from it?
Right.
So being that present, you're so in the moment that you do go up. You do forget where you are.
Right.
And then synapses are flying and it comes. It's like that next moment, you don't know what it is, and then it comes. And it would happen 30 times a night. And that's how, and then we realize that means I'm really here. And one night I went up and nothing came, and I was like 10 seconds on stage with that, and I was kind of relaxed, and you know how the adrenaline's going, and all the gears are going, like rewinding, where am I? Couldn't find it. So I said, excuse me, and walked off stage, and about 2 months earlier, I'd said to the stage manager, if this happens, I'm gonna come here. And I said, where am I? And she said, she didn't say anything, I didn't hear anything, come back. And, I said, where am I? And then I heard my line, and it went, oh, right, okay. Came back on stage, said, excuse me, and continued. There was another Q&A that night, and only one person remembered that it had happened.
Jesus.
And I was like, this is what we're so afraid of?
Yeah.
Are you kidding? And then when I was in England last year doing a comedy with a cast, so I had other people around me, and we'd trip up, and I went corpsing a couple of nights, which is their term for losing it on stage where you can't stop laughing.
What they call it?
They call it corpsing.
Wow.
And Tom Conti was in it, who then decided to make me corpse as much as possible, because that's their sport. it became, it was just, I forgot the point of this. Not the point of bringing in Tom Conti into this.
Put the worst thing that could happen on stage.
Yeah, I mean, and then, yeah, you really, yeah, thank you.
No problem. Because you're wondering why Sammy's here.
I was just going to say something like that. Thank
now
you for listening.
Now explain it to Jamie, why Sam's here.
Jamie?
So that he could chime in every now and then if we get lost. So, yeah, it's the here's what I'm afraid of, and that's also the thing that's magical about doing it.
Right.
Yeah.
You know, Goose Gossage had that, when he talks about getting Yastrzemski out in the final out of the 78 playoff, that Bucky Dent hit the home run. Because I met Goose Gossage and I told him how important that moment was to me. And he goes, yeah, well, thank you very much. I said, no, you don't understand. My son is named Augustus, and the only way I agreed to that is if we could call him Goose after you. And he gave me he realized that this was, you know, so he gave me a big hug and we just started talking. And he said that, I asked him about that final at bat, because Yastrzemski, you know, great all Hall of Famer, and it was a one-run game, and he said, at one point, I just said, fuck it.
Wow.
And it's like, you know, what, you know, the worst that can happen is we lose.
Yeah.
I mean, what the fuck?
They're not actually going to kill me.
Yeah. It's not Colombia, you know? And so he just started, and you could see him kind of loosen up, and he, if you look back at it, and he just firing fastballs, and your scrims popped out to nettles, and that was that. But that's true in any performance, I think. It's just, you know, the minute you say, I don't care. What's his name? I'm guessing that he lost. The Scott lost the British Open today? Any golf fan?
No. Oh, the British Open.
Ernie Els came back and won it?
I don't know. I know that a Brit won the Tour de France.
Okay.
Sorry, all non-U.S. sports here.
Go to the phone.
Gotcha.
Let's go to the machine. Go to the.
No, he. I think he, because I was watching the replay because it was on really early this morning, and I think Ernie Els came back and won. I was on the last hole, and I had to come here. But Tom Scott had a four-stroke lead,
right.
And the pressure, you know, it's like the pressure just, and everyone talks about it. All the golf guys talk about, you know, this is going to be the hardest round of his life because he's winning.
Right.
I mean, what kind of, you know, who are we to make? You're winning the British Open. It's
right.
The time of your life.
Yeah.
And so now it becomes the most torturous moment of your life.
Yeah. That's what everyone kept trying to convince me when I was playing in the World Series main event. As I got further and further deep into it, they'd say, well, you know, the pressure's on now because you have a chance. You could actually make it to the final table. And I said, A, no, that's not actually possible.
Great.
It's
a great
miraculous
thought.
That I'm here now.
Yeah.
And I'm on a free roll. And I'm laughing my ass off.
And now can you get them? That's a great attitude to have, but we should all always have it. So can you be there when the pressure, like if you're doing what you do, because you're not a poker player by trade, right? I mean, you do it.
I played my whole life, but it's definitely a hobby
and not a
profession.
Right.
I've only been nervous once going on stage.
Really?
In my life, yeah. And even like the first time on The Tonight Show with Carson walking out of that curtain, sitting down next to him, all those experiences to me were exciting as opposed to nerve-wracking.
Can we trade brains for just like a week?
No, because...
No?
Well, it is technically not an option.
It's difficult,
as
but...
As Jamie will tell you, your face can actually come off. We love the face-off. Ridiculous.
Oh, you got to love face-off. It's horrible.
He just wanted to trade brains, not
I
bones.
Know, and there's the man with two brains.
Why is he bringing skin into this? It's just the brains that I love.
Yeah. The transference is possible. No, but the idea that I finally get to do what I do, they're finally going to let me do what I do, isn't that incredibly great? As opposed to, oh, fuck, now what?
Yeah.
Am I going to fuck this up somehow? That just doesn't compute for
that's
me.
Great. No, that's awesome, because you've actually decided this is what you want to do.
Well,
I'm still working on that. I haven't quite decided that acting is right for me.
That's the thing at age 10 that happened for me. Please sit there uncomfortably, if you don't mind, while I pay a little more respect to one of our sponsors. Stamps.com. You know, they have this thing. People are always asking us they love that our podcast is free. They like it from the iTunes, from the Hulu. They love that it's free. And on occasion, they wonder, well, how the hell can we support you? Because we know making the show isn't free. And although my crew works for a stipend, and Sam shows up every week for nothing.
I got to fire somebody.
Yep. I don't know if I should have told you that you were here for nothing. So people are always asking, how can I support the show? Here's how. Our sponsors have developed ways for you to enjoy their particular product by using a code, something to do with this particular podcast. That's how you can sponsor and help support this show. We need you to at least sample the special offer that our sponsors have created just for you. It's not free to make this damn fine entertainment, so I'm asking you, try stamps.com, special offer available only to our fans. How much of your life, total, do you think you've wasted at the post office? If you have a computer and a printer, you can now do everything from work or home with stamps.com. I had to send out some merch from my little show business life. Somebody ordered my CD that I like to sign to them, and I ship it out. There's a free scale you get when you use the special offer. I hooked it up to the computer. I mean, I'm telling you, I'm 94% chimp. 98% chip. And this was so absurdly simple, even I was kind of a little tickled by, oh man, I'm not fucking this up. I mean, it really was pretty great. Use my name,
you
Kevin.
You are, you know, you fuck things up pretty
good. No, that's my MO. You know, I'm not nervous going on stage, but if there's anything technically in life, I will figure out a way to fuck it up pretty fast. Use my name, Kevin, when you go to stamps.com, and you'll get a free digital scale and up to $55 in free postage. I use stamps.com, as I mentioned, and it was just so ridiculously simple that I kind of have to insist you try this, folks. Go to stamps.com now. Before you do anything, click on the radio microphone at the top of their homepage and type in Kevin. That's all you have to do. If you want to support this show and do yourself a favor, stamps.com. Thank you to them.
18 months.
For caring so much about this show. 18 months?
That's how much of my life I've wasted in the post office.
Okay, you did the math? Thank you, Sammy. Thank you. I love that. Now, here's the next thing I need you to figure out. How many slices of pizza you've had in your entire life? Did you have a question?
No, he said the post office, and then I thought of, why is the postman wearing the bucket? Shouldn't you be wearing a bucket?
We're blind. Now we're going to Seinfeld.
Now we're going to Seinfeld. We're blind to their charity. Oh. Sorry.
Somebody tweeted, you know, we ask lots of questions from the folks. We get live questions from the folks at Twitter. We're going to throw a couple at you right from them. But someone on the Twitter said, ask him how many times he auditioned for Seinfeld. Is this a thing from your life?
Yeah.
Or are they making this up?
No, this was a thing. I must have told the story somewhere. I was there every Saturday for like 11 years. And there were, you know, 700 other character actors auditioning. Exaggerate a little.
Uh-huh.
And it was at CBS Radford.
Sure.
And it was at a time when my career was kind of, you know, starting. Little stuff started to happen. And
you're doing episodes of NYPD Blue. And
yeah,
stuff like
I mean
that.
Stuff was happening. There's some good films were happening, and I guess they. I heard there's a potential for me to be funny every now and then, so I was always there auditioning again and again and again on Saturdays, but there were so many people there, and it took so long for me to finally get into the room that by the time I got into the room, I was just fucking pissed off.
Right, you just walked in angry.
I walked in angry every week for 11 years.
That's the best.
So I was never really that funny. And I told that Larry David this, I think, when I ran into him on the golf course.
Oh yeah.
Said, you know, it's like I always, you know.
Couldn't get past the anger.
I couldn't believe it. Saturday, first of all, what are they doing auditioning on Saturday?
Right.
There's a bunch of Jewish people in that room. And he had every Saturday where like spending 3 hours at CBS Radford to come in and read four lines. You know, or sometimes two scenes or whatever. I just couldn't get around that.
Yeah. Well, what about the auditioning when you first came to the Los Angeles versus the theater auditioning? I mean, were you auditioning for commercials as well in New York?
No.
Back in the day, just theater?
No. I didn't audition for theater either, really. I started, how did this work? Well, I went off and directed because I was so afraid of acting, as you so acutely pointed out. Mm-hmm. And that was for a few years. And then I kind of got curious about acting and I got back into it. And the first play came out of the class I was studying. I was at William Esper Studio and they all kind of looked at me when we were done with our 2 years for plays. I had 800 plays in my apartment. We found a couple and it turned out that it was one that was good for a lead for me. Mm-hmm. And that's how it started. That was a hit, that play. Talking Minx, it was called. And then I would get offered another play. And, you know, I guess people used to go to backstage with their picture. I never had a picture, or I never did that. So, I mean, I did, but I didn't ever did it right, you know what I mean? I just had these stupid pictures. And
there was no effort. There was no proactive. There was no, this is up to you.
The effort was not to go. I just thought no one would ever hire me.
Right.
I mean, it's like, that was stupid.
I'm not going to waste my time with that.
And so I just thought, let me go create it. Or let me go follow that curious proboscis. Mm. And so that's what I did. And I ended up just finding people to work with. And, you know, and I did a few plays. And people just asked me to do plays. And then I, from that, I got the first film, couple of films I did. I did audition for the second film I got, which was Robert Longo, the artist, doing a short film. that Michael Stipes was the lead in. And Ray Liotta was in it, and Steve Buscemi was in it. And
everybody's in this movie I saw.
Arena Brains, it's called.
Buscemi, Bogosian?
Eric Bogosian was in it.
Yeah.
I think I auditioned with his monologue, in fact, because he wrote a great monologue for that movie.
Is that right?
And I almost was going to do it because his wife was going to have a baby, and they weren't sure if it was going to happen the day he was scheduled to shoot. And I think that's why I auditioned for that. So I was the backup in case he...
Crazy.
He was, yeah. But he writes so well. I mean, his monologues are so rich. I didn't really ever really do that. So when I got to L.A., I was kind of confused by this picture resume thing and this audition process. And it was, you know, sitcoms. And you go into a sitcom audition, which I'm sure you remember, and, you know, there's 43 people in suits, you know, and a few ladies. And I was sitting around a table, and it just again made me angry. So it was a long time getting over it here. It was a long time getting over or accepting what this town, the way they want to do business. It doesn't compute in my brain very well, and I just had to figure out a way to get around it and kind of take the power for myself. And then I realized. Is that what I came to conclude? Was that really I don't really want every one of these jobs, so I'm, you know, I'm going out and kind of practicing what I do for a living, which is audition now. When you're in L.A., that's what you do, and every now and then you get a little treat and you get to work.
Right.
You know, when you first come out here,
your job is to audition.
Your job is to audition. So I became good at it.
Right.
But I realized that what got the nerves out of my mind and this idea of being judged by these people who were selling soap, which was very confusing to me. I understand it now that I'm older, but at the time it just didn't make sense. And I realized that I really should be auditioning you. I mean, this is what I want to do with this role. If you react in a good way, then we can talk about working together.
Wouldn't that be nice?
And that's what I did.
Right.
And so I just realized I don't necessarily want to work with these people that don't get what, because I know I'm a little off the beaten path in terms of, I know that, you know, my choices are weird sometimes. And so I don't want to conform for the paycheck. I didn't really care about that. And that changed when my son was conceived. And then all of a sudden I went, okay, now
I got to work.
Now I want scratch.
Yeah. I want the boy to
first go. Job I did was Saved by the Bell.
Hello.
So there you go. When my son was conceived. And it was an offer. It wasn't an audition. And it was probably the worst day of my life.
What? Was that Saved by the Bell the original? Or
I don't know.
New class?
Huh?
What year?
I think that was the new class.
No, it was the guy. The what's their names?
What year are we talking?
94.
That's got to be the original.
No,
it was those kids. It was those really, except one of them was nice. The kid who's on...
Mark Paul Gosselaar.
Huh?
Mark Paul Gosselaar?
No.
On, Franklin Bash now?
The kid who's on the Hollywood,
Lopez.
Whatever it is.
Mario Lopez.
Yes, he was the only nice one.
I'm so sorry.
The other two are lucky they're alive. That's all I'm going to say.
Well, and there we have it.
There you have it.
They're still offering you the plays. You're going back to the Broadway to do Glengarry Glen Ross. That must start soon.
Yeah, in a month.
Yeah.
Rehearsals in September.
So we've got Cannavale in the Tony Roma.
Who's
Roma, Ray. Lovely.
Ricky Roma.
Ricky Roma.
Who's great? Who's a great actor, by the way.
Yeah.
He's really special.
Love the Cannavale.
Yeah.
We've got the Pacino in the Shelley the Machine Levine, right?
Yeah.
And who else? Do we know?
David Haber is playing, I think, Williamson. Oh, you got it on the phone?
Oh, no, I was... I think.
Are you texting your girlfriend? What's happening?
No, I'm researching. I'm researching stuff that we are discussing currently.
There's another gentleman who's very nice. He sent me a Twitter hello, who's in it, who's currently in Clybourne Park. And I don't have his name on my brain.
That's all right.
But he's in it. That's it, I think, for now. I don't think Moss has been cast yet. But, you know, I did the table read for the movie many years ago with Pacino and Jack Lemmon.
In which role?
Moss.
Wow.
And somebody had seen me in a play. I was doing a Thomas Bay play, David Ray play, mm-hmm. here in L.A. called Goose and Tom Tom. Another reason why I nicknamed myself.
You played Goose.
I did. And somebody saw that. I think it was actually Josh, what's his name?
Stop trying to remember name.
His father was a director, Josh Donnan.
Sure.
And the next thing I know, I'm reading, and Pacino's shooting Frankie and Johnny, and I'm reading in his house with Jack Lemmon and a bunch of Hollywood brats, and I'm reading Moss. Then I went to New York and auditioned, and I asked to read for Aronow as well, which I'm playing now, and it went really well. And they kept me in New York for a few weeks. And everybody else was cast, including my friend of mine, Bruce Altman, who was in the movie. I was like, what's going on here? And apparently they were keeping me as a kind of ace in the hole, but they were trying to get Ed Harris to break his contract for the infamous Boxing Helena. Mm. And in retrospect, I kind of figured they probably would have found some star to do it. In any event, they kept me there. 2 years later, I ran into Pacino, and he was reminded, you know, he remembered me, and he goes, you were fucking brilliant. You can do it. You were fucking brilliant. You were this fucking close. You were fucking brilliant. And he happened to be sitting next to Harold Becker, and Harold Becker goes, who's your agent? And that's how City Hall happened.
Is that right?
So which Pacino was in.
Yeah.
So and that's how Pacino and I kind of started.
You need someone like Pacino yelling at you, you're fucking brilliant, in front of the director of an upcoming film.
By the way, it's the only Hollywood party I ever went to.
Is that right?
And
to go to Mortem.
And I walked
up. You're batting 1,000.
And this old guy and Pacino were sitting next to each other, and I'm really shy, and I, for some reason, just walked up and said, do you mind if I sit down? And they went, And Pacino was really sweet, and we ended up working together a couple of times, and he talked to me about doing Huey on Broadway, which I couldn't do because I was going off to do The Lost World.
Right.
But I read with it. I wanted to read it with him first.
Sure.
Just for the experience of that, and then I said, by the way, I can't do this.
Oh no. This was just a little personal.
Which he had heard about, but we were just going to read it, and now I'm doing Huey right after Glengarry Glen Ross. I never did see the production that he did, but I'm sure he was brilliant. You know.
Right. So you'll be on the Broadway for a while.
Well, the second one's in Washington, at Washington.
Oh, Washington, right. And because the Glengarry's only a short run, Carnevale said.
Yeah, it's
five or six weeks.
It previews October 16th. It opens November 11th, and then I think they have to close after the extension on January 20th, and then January 21st, I'm teching in Washington.
Next day.
Yeah.
Nice.
I know.
Would you please take a question from our live witnessing audience?
How you doing? Are you still here?
I'm great. It was Saved by the Bell wedding in Las Vegas, you see.
What does that mean?
They shot it as a TV movie.
It was shot in L.A. That's all I'm telling you.
Right.
It wasn't the regular Saved by the Bell?
It was an add-on. It was the very last thing they did.
I was in the last thing they did?
You broke the show.
They brought you in because they needed the heavy hitters to end it well.
Yeah.
Well, I could have ended it for them without any other...
without showing up?
Yeah.
This is a rapid-fire question we play on the show.
Okay.
It's from Twitter, so it was named Tweet 5.
Tweet 5! Tweet 5!
You ever work with this maniac?
Tweet 5!
No. Dave Koechner? Crazy, no. Crazy with the funny. All right, these are designed specifically for the guests. They're rapid fire, 5 questions, Coke or Pepsi, this or that, no correct answer kind of scenario. But they're designed specifically for you. This
Coke.
Designed by at Max Von White. Here we go. Number one, inaugural or State of the Union?
For what?
Exactly.
Inaugural.
Correct. No idea. Josh Malina, Lost Soul or Evil Genius? See?
He's both of those.
Yeah, he is. Baseball or golf?
Baseball.
Stage or one-hour drama?
Stage.
Best side, left or right?
Left if I'm hitting the golf ball well.
Uh-huh. What does that mean?
I don't know.
Okay.
You got to be left-handed. You want to use your left hand to be dominant. You don't play, obviously. You want to use your left hand.
I don't play, obviously.
Well, it's okay. I'm not judging you.
He's more of a bowler.
It's a bowler. You don't want to do this when you're bowling. But it's just you want to, not the pros, but me, I want to just use my left side. And that's in my mind.
Pull through instead of.
Yeah, pull through, exactly.
I would come off the back leg too much, so I need to pull through to follow through.
Yeah, so I'm trying to stay on my front leg.
Yeah, me too.
And the whole left side.
Mm-hmm. So do you bat lefty?
I bat fungo better lefty.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, you switch?
I used to try to switch, but there was no reason when you're playing softball, because there's no real...
You can show off.
There's no real hard curve ball when you're playing softball.
But less people impressed.
Huh?
Less people impressed when you can switch in softball.
Yeah, well, they just think you're stupid, you know.
Make up your mind is what they yell.
Yeah.
Yeah. Here we go. Can we talk a little bit about Man of Steel? I mean, obviously it's next summer, so there's not too much I imagine they'll allow you to say. But you were offered and played allegedly pivotal role in the relaunch of Superman, entitled Man of Steel, directed by the amazing Zack Snyder. Of course, I love 300 and Watchmen. Dr. Emil Hamilton,
mm-hmm.
That's the name of the character. What the fuck? It sounds incredibly exciting. So what can you divulge? Did they force you to go to Comic-Con, for example?
No.
Okay. Probably next year.
I don't know.
Yeah.
I don't think so.
Okay.
I don't think it's gonna. I think, you know, Lois Lane and Superman and the bad guys. You know, is that out yet? Who the bad guys are?
Not that I know of.
Yeah.
I think it's all pretty.
It's a guy named Sammy, just so you know.
Perfect.
those are, I think, are the ones that the Comic-Con makes sense.
Right.
This could have been a Comic-Con type character.
Well,
but,
we'll see. We'll let them decide that.
Yeah.
So in the meantime, the phone rings one day, and it's Zack Snyder's people, or is it Zack himself? How did this?
Well, it goes through your manager and all that shit.
You get a call from your people first.
Saying they were all very excited.
Sure. It's a tentpole summer blockbuster.
Tentpole, yeah.
Yeah,
not a tentpole, but a tentpole.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, that's exciting. I haven't been, I think, in something this big since The Lost World, I don't think. This is up there.
Yeah.
It is for me.
Yeah. Maybe
I'm a big fan of yours, by the way.
Maybe it won't register for a year or so.
Is that clear at all?
When the damn no, it isn't. I think you need to spend a moment.
I am a big fan of yours. No, I am.
In what way? And
well,
why?
Not all comic actors.
Thank you.
Are able to really pull off dramatic roles.
Believably,
you are.
I was going to say internet talk shows.
What's that?
You thought you were going to say you can't pull off internet talk shows.
And I've always been really impressed with that.
Thank you very much.
Have you seen Deterrence?
No.
That's the one I wish people would see, actually.
I just need a minute. Just to,
sure.
Fans, do yourselves a favor.
No, boy.
DVR it when
What's
it's
happening?
On.
Never on.
Netflix. Go to if a brick-and-mortar video store still exists near you. Seek this movie out.
It's hard to find. It's weird that it's hard to find. Did you ever see The Contender, Joan Allen, Jeff Bridges, Gary Oldman? The guy that wrote and directed that, the film just before it, his first writing directing, his little political thriller called Deterrence. And thank you, Sam.
So you're very welcome. It's worth it to seek it out.
So you're serious. You're not making fun.
I'm being very serious.
I will check that out.
It's one of the few ones I'm actually proud of. I'm not terribly...
Which is why, of course, no one has seen it. I mean, I have like 11 of those.
Right?
Yeah. The best work you've ever done, and seven people, and you know, in your IMDb thing, it's like they show the money that all your movies have made, and it's like it's in the four digits.
Uh huh.
My favorite one is in the four digits.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's craft service.
And that's because I went like seven times.
Yeah.
Otherwise, it's in three digits.
Well, I said Aaron Sorkin's words correctly so very early in his career that he had a lot less to say about it. It was so early in his career how his words were said. And also it being a director's medium instead of television.
Right. That was Rob Reiner.
Yeah. In preparation for this, along with reading JMAC's 35-page dossier research, I watched a little bit of the Charlie Rose, where there were so many of you were sitting against the... Right?
But we did have a black curtain.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. We ripped them off carefully.
It was 360, just so you know.
Yes. I've been there.
I'm just...
Wait, no, it's 360 around here. What are you talking about?
Yeah. But in that, Aaron mentioned that for some reason it came up how Charlie, in his brilliant way, suggested that perhaps Aaron had something to do with the casting of the show. It's always nice when he shows his pure and 100% ignorance. Or maybe he just feigns that to give off the impression that he doesn't care. So Aaron was saying, yes, of course.
You gotta love Charlie Ross.
I cast the show. I do, which is why I try so desperately not to do his thing. And so Aaron did say, in terms of your involvement in that, that you had to beat out a whole bunch of people for the part, where he was saying, listen, if you can, he talked about how he got Martin involved. And Martin spoke about how he got, said yes. How was that part of the experience, getting the job? Because we talked about you getting offers here, there, and everywhere, including Spielberg, I think, on the Lost World thing.
Well, that came from an audition for his TV show.
Right.
I was very reluctantly going to audition for this single scene, High Incident, was that what it was mm-hmm. called? Out in Chatsworth and through pouring rain, and I almost turned around because I didn't think the part was right for me. It was like part of a beautiful part of a 70-year-old, I thought 70-year-old, who didn't have any age attached, agoraphobic, who was a jazz freak and was bothering neighbors because he was playing all of his albums, you know, Bunny Berrigan and all these old jazz albums. That's why I pictured him 70.
Sure.
But I loved the words enough to actually go see how it was going to come out of me. This is the Spielberg story. And I went and auditioned, and I think it was Denise Chamian, I forget, behind the camera. I didn't really know her at the time. And I auditioned for this thing, and it came out like, I was like, wow, that came out kind of interesting. And she didn't say a word, which, of course, made me angry. And I left, and I saw a 70-year-old African-American gentleman sitting in the waiting room as I left, the only other one there, and I said, congratulations. I left. And
you probably thought, what did that kid mean?
I literally said, congratulations, go get it, you know, something like that. And and then on the way home, my manager called me and said, not only did you get the part, but Steven Spielberg wants you for his next movie. And I went, I'm sorry. And
but I told the other guy that he had the part.
Well, apparently he was. I didn't know what Spielberg
was. Morgan
was
Freeman wasn't
producing. Yeah. was producing this TV show, and he was in the next room. So Denise, I hope it's Denise, picked up the cassette and just played it for him, right then and there. And then I got the call, and then I met him when I shot my little scene, and it was kind of cool. But in this case, you know, it's a funky story, The West Wing, and it I don't know, it's curious and it disappoints some people. You know, I remember being on panels, and John Spencer, God bless him, he was always he's such an actor. Mm-hmm. He loves the whole thing, probably more than you. He loves the makeup, he loves the eye patches in the morning, you know, the gossip, he called the prizes, the awards, which I just, you know, have trouble with. And all the stuff that I'm neurotic about, he just loves it.
Yeah.
He has his other demons, you know, obviously, sure. But he loves the whole thing. And he used to say, oh, we all so desperately wanted this show, and I would like kind of sit on my hands, because that's not my story. You know, my story was, I was supposed to do a Wim Wenders movie, and it conflicted with the West Wing pilot. And I was asked straight out, which do you prefer? Because they conflict. This is before I got the West Wing, but I had to go through the whole process.
Sure.
And I said, the movie, that's not even close. Because I thought NBC would never hire me. I knew Tommy and Aaron, Tommy Schlamme, I'd worked with them before. I knew they liked me a lot. But the year before, I had a test deal with NBC, and I kept them up all night. I had turned down like 3 test deals already, and so my price kept going up. So I realized I didn't want to do TV. Mm. So you get these deals, and I would be driving around the ABC building and getting calls going, where are you? I go, I'm on Avenue of Americas. Are you going in? And it's, I don't know. I would imagine myself on the set of this particular sitcom, and I went, that's not what I want to do. So I couldn't go park my car. And this happened like 3 times, and then this other show, which actually was a really nice show, and Michael Jeter was in it, and I liked it. But I put up my price here because I realized I'm on this nice path with films and I want to do films. And that's how I saw myself.
Right.
And 2 o'clock in the morning, I got a call saying they caved. I go, what do you mean? Oh, they caved. You got your price. So I went, oh, okay. They want you to come in at 8 o'clock. I go, what? And at 8 o'clock, that's like 5 hours from now. It's like I put this thing to bed. It takes me all night to. My thing is like a house of cards, you know, and something in me just, I didn't want to go. And I just said, no, I'm not going to go at 8 o'clock. I'll go at 10, knowing full well somewhere that that was going to be impossible. And they said, you'll never work at NBC again if you don't go. I said, I'm not going at 8 o'clock. So they're going to be furious. I'm not going to go. I don't know. I'm sometimes out of my mind, I know, but... So I didn't go, and they were furious. So this is a year later, and I'm going, yeah, they're never going to hire me, so why bother?
They hate you in your mind.
They hate me. Yeah. So why, of course, I'm Vin Vendors. I mean, I wouldn't want to work with Vin Vendors. Well, this was supposed to happen, this Vin Vendors movie, actually, and I was expecting it to happen, and it was if Steve Buscemi dropped out, then I was going to be the next guy, and I'm Vin Vendors' new favorite person, blah, blah, blah. And everyone expected Steve to drop out because he was going to direct a film, and then he did. And then Vin Vendors, those people said, come and audition. You have to come in and audition again. And I said, I'm sorry? And they said, oh, he's just a little crazy, and there's one other actor. And I got offended by that because he literally said to my face, you're going to do this if, and we expect him to, Steve drops out. And so now to come in again after, again, putting away the work. And it's really about that for me. It's just like, you know, it takes me a while to build this stuff. You know, I can't just go in and go, hey, look at me. It's like that look at me thing. I actually have to have work.
You poor bastard.
That I know, it sucks. I actually have to build something that makes me want to do it.
Yeah.
I can't just go in and do it just for the fuck of it.
You were taught to care.
Well, I had no choice but to care. I'd much rather not care. It's much easier.
Right.
And people are great when they don't care. And I just can't be that way. You know, for me, I have to build up enough crap that makes me push out what I want to say.
Right.
Well, you know, it sucks. So I didn't go in, and we all went to somebody else. And I was a little actually depressed when I went in for the West Wing. And... I did see Alice and Janney at one of the auditions, and I went, well, wait. I kind of perked up and went, if she gets cast, maybe these guys know what they're doing. Because I had met her, but I was a huge fan of hers already. And I went through the process, and I was god-awful in the test, which I said to Tommy after the Warner Brothers version of the test. He came out outside the room, and I said, just so you know, I might not show up tomorrow. And he went, yeah, we've heard that. And then I said, and if I show up, I'm going to suck. And he goes, yeah, we've heard that too, but we really want you to come. And it was very, very sweet, actually.
Wow.
And it kind of gave me the feeling that I should come.
Right.
And so I went, and I was fucking god-awful. I mean, I so bad that I giggled and stopped 3 different times. I know that's how
and
bad.
This is in front of the studio or network?
The studio, the network. No, this is the network now. The NBC.
Come back for the network.
There's that little office, and they're all kind of stacked up like it's a portrait. You know, they're all on top of each other.
Was it Warren Littlefield's office at that point?
I think so.
Probably.
It wasn't. Who was before that? The wonderful guy.
Tartikoff.
Yeah.
It certainly wasn't him.
I used to play softball with Brandon Tartikoff, and before I knew that he was the.
Not Sassa, Scott Sassa.
No,
before Sassa.
No, yeah, Scott came later.
This is Littlefield, for sure.
I'm pretty sure it was Littlefield. It was part of the reason I think Jeff Zucker was never really a fan of the show because it wasn't his show.
Right.
It was Littlefield's, right?
Yeah.
But anyway.
So you came back and you sucked in front of the network. You broke 3 times laughing.
Yeah.
And they said, we want him.
Apparently they did. And I hope he doesn't mind me telling this story, but you know the other guy that was the finalist?
No.
It's fascinating because it's his name, of course, just popped out of my head.
Uh-oh.
Yeah, American Pie.
Jason Biggs?
No, the father.
Oh, Eugene Levy.
Eugene Levy came up to me years later and said, you know what, I was the other guy. And I was so like this, I didn't, And he went, I was sure I got that role. I said, why? He said, because I put my ear against the door and I couldn't hear a fucking word he was saying. Because I was so, like, you know.
Wow.
And he would have been.
I put my ear to the door. Let's pause for a moment and picture him outside Warren Littlefield's office, literally with his ear to the door.
But there were guys that would do that. They would listen, and I didn't want to know what other people were doing. But I mean, we would see people at these tests, you know, kind of pretending that they weren't hearing. Of course, Eugene is bold enough. He's just going to put his ear against.
Yeah.
I think he's a brilliant guy, really brilliant, and he would have been great in that role. I just think it was a choice between dark or...
He sat here for 2 hours and never mentioned this. Now I'm upset.
I hope I didn't reveal something that he doesn't want revealed publicly.
Oh, no.
You know what? He did fine.
We've all, yeah.
You know what? I mean, he ended up doing the movies that I would have loved to have done, so yeah. There you go.
You know the direct-to-DVD ones of the American Pie movies? And I certainly hope he doesn't mind me sharing this. Do you know what his deal is on that?
Huge.
$1 million... No more than 5 days' work. That is correct.
I think that information is something he would not want.
I'm sorry.
I'm just saying.
I'm just saying, as now, an actor, that's the holy grail, where they respect you enough where you're like, look, you're the only thing that's going to legitimize these movies.
Right.
We'll give you anything you want. All right, I don't want to work more than 1 week, and you owe me $1 million.
I get that pitch done for these little independents, but there's no seven figures waiting for me when I'm done.
I think Michael Winslow got the same deal for the police academy.
That's a terrific reference.
That was an original thought.
Yes.
I have original thoughts, people. It's not all quotes.
It's not all Simpsons quotes.
That's an original.
You know, it's time to tip our hats, I think, to the GoDaddy.com people. We can't leave them out of this. There's a great new GoDaddy.com offer for you, the fans of this show. Get your .com for only $5.99. You're going to get a new domain name anyway. You want to set up a new email address. The place to do it is GoDaddy.com. It's easy, it's affordable, it's a name you know and trust. It's the one I use, and I ain't kidding, damn it. Isn't that all that matters? By the way, if you need a website, a fan blog, son's little league team, fantasy football, even get a website for your kids, it's 21st century, people. What are we talking about? Come on. Go to GoDaddy.com. Did you know, for example, that Richard Schiff is an awesome son of a bitch.com is available? Well, it is. So is Kevin Pollock is a suckup.com. Yep. GoDaddy.com is the most popular, most recognized. Go to GoDaddy.com for a limited time now. Fans of this show, use a secret code and pay only $5.99 for that new .com name. That's right, $5.99. Just go to GoDaddy.com, type in the code Kevin599, and you'll spend a scant $5.99 to register a new .com name. GoDaddy.com. Do it now, you son of a bitch. So we get past the wonderful Warren. Now, would you like some water?
No, I'm still okay. I'm still nursing the coffee.
No, we can get you another one, by the way, if you want another.
Yeah, I do.
Okay. Can we get another Cafe Americano, please? What'd you put in that? Anything?
Nothing.
Nope, just straight. Please. Thank you.
A whiskey?
I'll take one.
Yeah, two. Make that two. Kenny?
Actually, yeah, make mine decaf.
A little vodka bourbon? Would you like a decaf?
Yeah, if they got
If they got the decaf button in there.
So you
got
to work at 6 in the morning.
And a regular calf.
All of a half double, half calf, double in at half calf? No, I'm doing it wrong.
Are you doing
Steve Martin?
Trying to do it right. My brother's screaming right now.
I'm at that scene.
Oh, half calf,
I'm in that
half
scene.
Half calf with a twist.
How about
that's
this?
It. Right.
You know what? I'm in that scene and you don't know that.
The table round thing?
Yes.
My favorite line from that movie. And one of my favorite lines of all time.
Wow.
Is he's driving his girlfriend, Steve Martin, up the street in L.A. And he says, some of these houses are over 20 years old.
It really is terrific.
Yeah, that's a great movie.
Who else, by the way? Well, first of all, let's get to the... is there a first table read on the pilot? I imagine there is, for the West Wing.
Yeah.
Okay, so that's the first time you really see the entire cast together.
Yes.
And then what are your thoughts at that point, having gone through what you did to be a part of this?
Well, I mean, I was very sure that it was going to be a big deal, a big hit.
It's on the page.
Yeah, it's on the page. And I don't know why. I have a good instinct about these. I did one or two other shows and knew... one was great, called Relativity,
right,
which I loved. Still my favorite character I've ever played. And I kind of knew that it was not going to last very long. And this one, I just had a sense that it was going to last two terms. I didn't know they were going to start us in the second year, because I would have said 8 years, but it ended up 7 years. And, you know, there's a panic in Hollywood, because so much is at stake, and there's this desperation that exists. I mean, I just did another pilot recently for a show that probably will be very successful and without me, which is fine. And it was just that panic. This was a comedy, and it's worse in a comedy, because you guys are always desperate to be funny, right?
Mm, yeah.
And there's just this thing, and it's very unpleasant for to be around, to be quite honest. That was an element from Tommy and Aaron, to be honest, and they had every right to be, because they knew this was their shot. You know, this was a big shot.
Yeah.
The actors were kind of great, you know. And Martin, it was my first time meeting Martin, so he is just a delightful clown.
Yes. I mean,
he's just...
What a goofball.
He's a goofball, and at the same time, one of the great hearts of all time.
Yeah.
And to this day, I say, the best human being I've ever met in my life.
Inside
or next out? To my wife. Yeah. He's a remarkable, remarkable man.
Yeah.
And so he balanced everything out. I think, you know, he just kind of created this joyous atmosphere, and everyone was excited and nervous. So it was interesting, you know. I mean, it was interesting.
And coming from the theater like you did, you were used to, other than those moments when you would turn up stage and giggle, you were used to the 100% reverence. And
of the written word,
and down to the letter. And most film and TV actors can't fathom that sort of reverence. It's just not part of the vernacular in terms of why they want to be an actor, what they do when they get to work. So did it because of that naturally come easier? Well, I guess none of this is easy for you, as I'm understanding it.
Yeah.
But those things that can drive an actor mad about working with Aaron and his stick-to-the-letter principles, as a playwright first, at least we forget.
And someone who writes in meter, so that's why it's like I'm doing Glengarry. He's not going to want me to improvise on the ums and the ers, you know. It's written to music, and Aaron does the same thing.
Right. And that made sense to you from the get.
It did. I have to say, though, that I found out in retrospect that Aaron was really angry because I did improvise a little bit on the audition. And I was so used to improving.
At auditions, at TV auditions in
At
particular.
Auditions and films. I mean, in films you have the freedom.
Yeah.
Usually people are very appreciative of it. I do have a sense of the written word.
Sure.
And
I do it all the time.
Yeah. I mean, we improve it, even just the little subtle
but
thing.
You make it your own.
You make it your own, but it's also, I mean, I have a sense of the story. So there's a little thing that you might put in there that kind of ties in something else. And, you know, I'm always kind of aware of that. Are you allowed to just walk right in?
Yeah, watch.
Excellent.
We have to pay him for that now.
Oh, that's why he slipped in there. Yeah.
No, they kept the camera angle. He was okay. Dr. Chen was not seen.
Can I have some sugar? No,
yeah,
just kidding. No, I'm kidding. I just wanted to get him paid. Where am I?
You were talking about the audition and improvising.
Yeah, so I found out later that he was... He was
not pleased.
Not pleased, but adjusting to that wasn't a problem at all. I mean, it was hard to learn lines at all that early on that fast, but it became a muscle that became, you know, very well trained. So by the end of the first year or the second year, you know, what took me 5 hours or 6 hours to learn, I could do in a half an hour. Which we had to. We had no choice.
Right.
And so, by necessity. And that muscle is still very active. It's the long-term memory muscle that is a problem for people that do a lot of TV and movies, because they go back to theater and it's like, shit, I got to do this again tomorrow.
Yeah.
And so you have to, it's literally a different way of learning. But no, I respected the music. And when I had a question about the writing with Aaron, I had his ear for whatever reason. And I think it's probably because the first few times I went to Aaron and Tommy, I was giving away lines. I went to them, I said, this seems like Josh's voice. And they would go, you know, you're right. And he would get this half a page monologue. And I kind of felt that my character, Toby, was one of those people. I loved the fact that he was a communications director, and I love opposites, who couldn't communicate very well.
Right.
So to me, that makes him a minimalist in terms of when he spoke. And I really wanted him to speak only when he had to, which is very close to the way I am on stage anyway, right? I mean, unless I have to speak, I really just want to go home.
Right.
And so so we kind of ran with that a little bit, and Toby became kind of more the quieter one. And so when I went to them, I said, I think this thing has this, you know, this idea would be different, or I think that should be mine. They already had respect for the fact that I wasn't one of those actors that just cared about his own. I really did care about the whole picture.
Right.
And
which is a little surprising to them creatively.
Yeah, I mean, very much appreciated. I mean, especially Tommy. And Tommy and I had a really great relationship over 7 years, and he always respected my insanity. And I love him for that.
He directed a great deal of them, and of course the pilot.
And he was always overseeing.
He was the guy on the floor when Aaron couldn't be anyways, no?
Yes, and when he wasn't, he was the first phone call.
Right.
And then I kind of got assigned to be the guy to watch out in case a guest director didn't quite understand what was going on, which led me to some trouble with directors that, like, 4 years later go, him? No. Richard Schiff? No, because I had made a phone call on him.
And
I was just kind of protecting us. And because of my directing years or whatever the reason, and because, I'm a sick fuck, I don't know why, I could see the whole picture. And I would call and go, I don't think this is going the way you might want it to go. And Tommy would come down and fix it.
Right.
But I really, really have such respect and love for Tommy. Because of he got that I was a little sick in the head, but he loved it.
Right.
And
you saw how much you cared. I mean, that's the bottom line of all of this. You can tell when an actor cares and when one doesn't.
Well, you know, I've worked with these actors, and you have as well, who get these reputations of being, you know, difficult or odd or weird or whatever. Dustin Hoffman being one of them. Pacino, when he was younger, had that reputation. And then you meet them, and it's really, they just care so much that, it's a problem, because you have to address their very brilliant perception of what's going on.
Right. A lot of times it's rampant insecurity or suffering from I don't deserve this, or various things from the stars at the top who sabotage the work around them because they just are organize their thoughts by fear and insecurity, and they're terribly unhelpful to the process as a whole. And then in between those are the actors who are a pain in the ass because they care so much.
That was beautifully said, actually. It really was.
I've worked with both, and I can tell the difference in about 4 minutes.
It takes about 4 minutes.
Why they're being an asshole.
If they're an asshole, you mean?
Right. Yes.
How do you figure Tommy Lee Jones?
Doesn't suffer fools, and I've not worked with him, so I'm definitely speaking from the bleachers. But it seems to me Duff doesn't suffer fools and is surrounded by fools, as we are in this business almost all the time.
And so it could be trigger happy.
Yeah.
He just has an impulse, a reflex reaction.
Yeah.
He was not pleasant when I worked with him very briefly, and I think he's brilliant. I mean, really brilliant. But he did some stuff on the first day of the movie, and I was really upset by it. Because it's kind of pissing, you know, first day, and people like that need to piss.
Yeah.
And claim their territory and say, don't fuck with me, or whatever they do. And the way that was done that first day was really offensive to me. So he's going to find me and kick my ass now.
Yeah, he's got to get through me.
Good.
Yeah, I got your back.
There's no way Tommy Lee Jones knows how to work the internet. Who are we kidding? There's not a chance.
What's this thing you put in front of me?
Isn't Gore his best friend? Didn't Gore
invent? They were roommates in college.
Didn't they invent the internet together?
Yeah. Yes, they did.
What's this thing you put in front of me?
And, but by the way,
I got to read this.
But by the way, I'm sure I'm accused of being the asshole the time that I just said Tommy Lee Jones.
Yeah, just a second. I'm working on my Tommy Lee Jones.
Sorry, so sorry.
What's this thing you put in front of me? What do I want to look at this? Somebody tell me what I want to take a look at this. I'm not interested.
Okay.
You've got to tell me a little bit about Zack Snyder.
Tommy Lee Jones after the stroke?
Yeah.
Or was that Josh Brolin doing Tommy Lee
Jones? Yeah, that's what it was, actually. You got to tell me a little bit about Zack Snyder working with him. Still pretty young guy, right? What's he, mid, early 30s?
He certainly acts young if he's not young. He's a kid in a toy store.
Ball of energy, right?
Kid in a toy store. He's just having
fun. You got to love that enthusiasm of his.
It's, you know, it's like you've been invited over to a kid's house when you're young. And he's got every toy on the planet.
Richie Rich.
And he's just like, and every time he touches something that it may have been there for a year and a half, it's as if it's the first time. It's a new toy.
Yeah.
It's like, have you seen this thing? You throw it up in the air and then you catch it? You know, I mean, he's excited about everything. But he's also a great guy. He's also, he's having fun. He's in total command. There's no tension on his set, which is really unusual. And everybody loves him, and he loves everybody, and it's just a lot of fun.
What a great environment.
Yeah, he's quite impressive that way.
Yeah.
And you go off having a catch with the football in the hangar at Edwards Air Force Base, you know, in between shots, and he's an athlete. He's deeply into working out. Apparently at his house, he's got a whole gym.
I would think
people,
so.
People come over and use. You know, they got their own lockers and stuff. He's really into.
He has fellas come over and there's lockers for them?
Yeah, he was telling me like he's got a gym that he just built his own because he wanted it to be right and he loves it, so he invites people over and I think they can just drive onto his property and use it whenever they want.
That's pretty awesome.
I didn't ask for a locker, but
No, you didn't.
No. I have my 8-pound dumbbells at home.
Is that what you're using these days?
No, I have a couple of machines that I put in my office because I used to get sick going to the gym all the time, flu season.
Sure. You want to stay away from the germs?
I want to stay away from the germs. I'm okay sneezing. I'm okay working out on sneezed on equipment if it's my sneeze.
What are the machines you have there?
I don't think anyone has ever before on this earth said that sentence. Pretty sure that's true.
Well, let's leave it
that
there
might
then.
That might be true.
I want a couple more things, if you don't mind, about The West Wing. You directed a couple of episodes, at least two, I know of.
Two, yeah.
But I want to hear about running into Dan Bartlett in the lobby of the Ritz-Carlton in D.C. when you asked him, what do you think of your boss as a human being?
Okay.
If you don't mind.
I'm trying to remember the
year. For those
year.
Who don't know, his boss at the time would be...
George W.
W.
Yeah.
And he was your version in real life, the press, communications.
He was the communications, no, he was the press secretary.
Press secretary.
So that was CJ, that was Allison.
Right, right, right.
And I was the communications director.
Right. It's not the exact same job.
No, but same team.
Yeah.
We were in the Ritz-Carlton, which is where we stayed when we shot in D.C. Back in the days when television shows had money.
Mm-hmm.
And that, you know, the word lobby comes from people would hang out in lobbies and affect and try to run into senators and congressmen and affect their vote. I mean, that's where the word comes from. So down in the lobby of the Ritz-Carlton, there were lobbyists. You know, one day I got to know the organic meat lobby.
Sure.
And who for some reason I put over there.
well, behind you and to the right.
Behind the black curtain.
Uh-huh.
And then we're sitting there, so people of repute come into that lobby.
Do they?
Yeah. And I'm sitting there with, I'm remembering her name is Bird York, which is her musical name. But she played my ex-wife on the show, and I'm sitting there with her, and it's just after we invaded Iraq, or within a few months. And Dan Bartlett, who's a very tall and pleasant gentleman, comes up to us and says, I'm sitting with my wife on the other side of the lobby, and she said, the least I can do is say hello.
Wow.
So I said, well, what do you mean the least you can do? Sit down and have a drink. I'll buy you a drink. And he goes, okay, and we're sitting down. And what's her first name? Bird York. You can look her up. She was nominated for an Oscar for a Crash. She wrote the song. You remember?
I actually know Bird, but you I only did. Know her as Bird also.
Oh, really?
Yeah,
I'm trying
my
to
previous
remember
life.
Her actor's name. But anyway, she started just pummeling him with questions, like, what are you doing with this war, and blah, 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 blah. And so we have this flank, so I decided to take the more diplomatic approach, and I'm asking him different questions and kind of ameliorating the attack. And at one point, you know, we kind of get him into a conversation, and he's answering it like a press secretary would. There's no false moves anywhere. And I said to him, what do you think of your boss as a man? And he said, wow, no one's ever asked me that before. And he's listed about 12 qualities that one would consider positive, you know. He's faithful.
His work ethic.
His work ethic. He comes to work on time. He's loyal. He's blah, blah, blah. Whatever the things that people think are good, he would list. And then he also said, you know, and I've known this man for, I think, 13 or 14 years. I'm trying to remember the number, but he didn't have trouble remembering the number. 13 years, let's say. I worked for him as a governor of Texas. You know, been through hard times with him, been through good times with him. And in all this time, he has not changed not one iota. And he was saying to this to me as if it's a good thing. And I said to him, huh, I've had four epiphanies since you sat down. I that's the scariest thing that you could have told me.
Because he ran a baseball team into the ground, he ran a stadium
Thank
into the
you.
Ground.
He ran, yeah, he came in last place and he failed as a baseball owner. He failed as an oil man, allegedly had drug issues, allegedly had some desertion issues, you know, not quite, I'm just kidding on that one, but, you know, and became governor.
I think he was more of a no-show than a desertion.
Yeah, fair enough. Somehow became governor, and then somehow becomes the president of the United States, goes through the worst attack of the history of our nation, decides to invade two countries, bombs the shit out of, you know, kills 100,000 Arabs on the first day. And you haven't changed one iota? That's the scariest thing that I could possibly hear. Mm. Yeah, that was that.
And he had a press secretary answer to that, I'm sure.
Well, I didn't go into the full detail of that response, but I just said that scares me.
Yeah.
I mean, that scares me.
And then Bird got in his face with the next one.
I mean, the conversation, it stays very polite. As these guys are very good.
Oh, boy, are they.
At not showing their disdain for your presence.
That's a great way to put it. That is perfectly articulated, actually. Because you can see it in their eyes. Do you spend much time in the backyard barbecuing when you have a chance?
No.
No? You don't have the barbecue gene?
No, I do it. I do it out of I'm ordered to do it.
Out of instruction.
Once the people are here,
mm-hmm.
and it was called a barbecue.
They get angry.
I realize that I got to, like, somebody's got to do this shit.
Right.
So I once I start, it's like I'm cooking every hamburger. I'm basting every rib. And that's my day.
Yeah.
And I end up, you know, with like a charred beard. But that's I can't give up the thing, the fork.
The control?
Yes.
Are you a carnivore by nature?
think so. I don't know if that's a learned thing.
Yeah. I don't think it
is. You watch somebody else kill an animal, and then it's like, all right, yeah, no, I think it's...
Since you killed it, I might as well have a bite.
Yeah. Yeah.
Why'd you go to Old Jewish Man for that?
What are these questions?
This is...
Is this a Rorschach test of
No, I wanted to use the opportunity of our 153rd show to prove that, unlike previous attempts, I could offer up one of the worst segues in the history of broadcast.
Did I ruin that for you?
No.
Excellent.
No, you helped me to call a spade a Kevin Pollock. It's the summer, people, and that means it's grilling time for most folks. If you love the grilling, please take advantage of this sweet offer from the fine folks at Mangrate Grill Enhancement System. What's a Mangrate, you ask? Shut the hell up. Mangrates are 100% made in America, cast iron grilling grates that deliver that sweet steakhouse flavor you seek. We've all been to those fancy joints, and they always have that insanely delicious flavor from their grill. Now, you'll achieve the same damn goodness with Mangrate. I am a barbecue snob, you son of a bitch. They sent me one. I was skeptical. I was. I said, what is this? And then I attached a few pieces that go on the grill there to give it that incredible smokehouse flavor, and there it was. It just happened. I kind of didn't have to do anything. Flavor you can get only from those overpriced steakhouse. Now, you can take advantage of a $20 Kevin Pollak's Chat Show special offer today by clicking on the Mangrate banner at the Kevin Pollak's Chat Show website. That's Mangrate Grill Enhancement System. Support this show simply by giving them a try today. Thank you. Sorry about that. I just wanted to prove that I could clunk it up.
No, I like the. I actually like the segue, as it turned out. I just got a text saying somebody said Man of Steel looks amazing. I don't know how they know that.
There are teaser trailers out playing in front of the new Batman movie.
Ah.
And online.
Did you see it?
I did.
And?
Looks amazing.
Sammy, you buried the lead. Talk to us.
Am I in the trailer now?
What'd you see?
There's almost nothing in the trailer. The teaser that they showed before my screening of Batman,
Oh, is this the one online with the ships and the guy and the thing? No.
No, I think that's another one. I haven't even seen that one. This one is just sort of, it's a voiceover. I think it's Russell Crowe doing the voiceover. And you see, like, Superman is like a boy. And kind of the cape, and then there's this big wide shot of him as an adult flying, and you basically see like sound waves bouncing off of him as he's breaking the speed of sound, flying straight up into outer space. Looks phenomenal.
Yeah.
It's a CGI movie, let's face the facts.
It's Zack Snyder's thing. I mean, this guy, you know, it's so hard to be an original artist in any medium. And then you start directing, which you have, and you get a sense of following a certain path, in the case of West Wing, or even in Treatment, which I really love. It's not a director's medium. So in the film world, to have an original voice, when you have so many masters to please, becomes nearly impossible. And that's why when I saw 300, I was so taken back by, how did he reinvent this wheel?
Mm-hmm.
And I think I saw somewhere an interview with you, you said, was it you that said my son saw it and then I thought I'd watch it too, or is that Watchmen?
No, that's 300.
It was 300.
Yeah, yeah.
And you said your son was a bit of a film snob, so when he said, Dad, this is pretty cool, that's what interested me.
He's not even a film snob, it's just that I really trust his taste. He's got really good taste. And when he likes something, there's always a really good reason for it.
That's interesting.
We don't always like the same thing, but there's a real specific reason why he likes something and why he doesn't, and he can spot, good quality from shite.
Yeah.
And he loved 300. Yeah.
Well, it's good that you say this is a special effects movie, CGI, because, you know, no one can actually fly. So, technically. And I don't want the guy lying on the board like on the TV series.
I think you just ruined the whole fucking movie for people.
You know, the TV series, they had the guy on like the bench that you use for the bench pressing.
So he tilted every now and then.
He did this.
That's what convinced me when I was eight.
This was the Superman TV show.
Not to be a total comic book nerd,
yes.
But I do know this. What? Technically, yes? Superman's not flying.
What's he doing, Sam?
Technically, he's jumping.
Is he?
Able to leap tall buildings in a single bound.
No, that's an extra. They just didn't put the flying in the intro. Because you see him doing this, you don't have to say that. But to leap single buildings in, what is it?
A single bound.
Or there's the Jewish superhero, Superman, who could lease a tall building in a single call.
You know that Superman was created by Jewish people.
Tell me about this.
Not the Jewish people.
I saw this in the dossier. One of the things that fascinated you about it was you were asked if you were much of a comic book fan of the Superman series as a kid, and you said, no, it was around, the TV show was around. But then I started to do a little research, and I found that it was almost propaganda in a sense.
Yeah, it was a response, really, to the growth of Nazi Germany,
right.
to the kind of, what do you call it? What's a good way?
Expansion?
Well, the
domination.
The looming threat.
Right.
And that this was a couple of Jewish artists' response to that, calling up very American values from, and it's kind of fascinating when you think about it, these Jewish, I don't know the real details of these guys, but I'm guessing they were immigrants. I don't know that if they were born in the States or not, but kind of like Frank Capra and the way he embraced American values to the point, you know, to where, in a Sorkinese way, you know, I mean, he loved America and he loved democracy, and these guys loved American values and kind of created, in their minds, I'm sure, was a Jewish superhero.
Right.
But just like Hollywood, they said, let's make him look like Robert Goulet so no one knows, you know. We'll give him the blue hair and, you know, no one will think he's Jewish, and then we'll actually can sell this thing.
Right.
But that's where it comes from, and I just thought that was kind of great.
America's value.
Jerry Siegel and Joe Shuster.
Were the two...
Where were they born?
Original artists? Gotta be immigrants.
Cleveland, Ohio for Siegel.
Well, that's another country.
You are right. And I'll let you know about Shuster. Shuster, Canadian.
See, from the old country.
I didn't know any of this. There you go.
Well, so wrong on the theory that they're European.
Well, they were, but you're not wrong on the fact that they were both super Jews.
Super Jews.
Siegel and Shuster.
I don't know what that means, but that's okay.
They're very Jewish.
They're very Jewish.
Very Jewish. Siegel.
Siegel.
So a lot of working in London. You touched on that briefly, but you've worked in the West End several times. And also, are you a regular on House of Lies? Is that a thing or recurring?
Not anymore. I was recurring. I did like half of the shows. And a character that I actually loved, this guy, and had a great time. Don Cheadle's a friend, and we golfed together. And I love Matt Carnahan, the writer, and it was a great time on that show. And
it's a spectacular show, by the way.
The whole
not get enough recognition.
The whole cast. Kristen Bell is like,
everyone's,
you know,
phenomenal. It's Ben Schwartz's show.
Ben Schwartz was here.
Ben was here.
Long
well,
ago.
He's a sweet guy and very funny. And Josh
Lawson.
Thank you.
You're
welcome. Josh Lawson. The whole set is great. It was one of those really fun jobs, and I got to do what I want. You know, I got to be creative and improvised and got to create this really odd character, you know, and still fit into the style of the show, which was the challenge.
Right.
And I loved it. I had a great time, but I'm not sure I'm going to be able to come. I did leave the last episode on my exit. I did improvise this line, which was, "You just started World War III, pal." No, I said, "You better nuke up. You just started World War III." Because I wanted to come back.
And they left it in, so.
Yeah, they left
and
it
they
in.
Said, and they said, the producers came up to me, it was my last shot, and they said, well, I guess you have to come back. But it's going to be very difficult to commute and still make the matinee on Wednesdays, you know.
Yeah.
So I don't.
It sounds like theater's got you booked up for the next year.
Yeah, pretty booked up until through March.
Wow. When does Glengarry, you said it starts in December, the premiere?
Although if you're watching this live, I could use a job between now and September.
Opening night.
10th, like a really well-paying guest star spot.
A juicy little three-week thing.
But the kind of salary they used to pay like 7 years ago.
Right.
I really need
You don't want to hear
right
Top of Show?
Top of Show. They're going to find a way to go like Top of Show minus the 10%.
Right.
I mean, no, right. No scale plus 10 anymore.
I got you bottom of show.
Yeah. Bottom of show. The good news is that you have like 10 scenes, but you're getting paid. You're basically a background artist.
Yeah.
In terms of money.
I was just asked to do a 10-week run, episode run on a very, very successful show, like insanely successful. And we didn't have any money.
And so?
You don't have any money.
Sullivan and Son?
You want me to spend 10 years of my life?
And what did you say?
I said, I don't have that kind of time.
Not with the World Series behind you.
Yeah, well, you can make that kind of, you can make the same scratch with your winnings on that poker game.
If I could have made,
those winnings at the ponies, man.
They started with the scale plus 10 stuff like about what 5 years ago.
Yeah,
and that's when I've been offered on. I think it was James Woods' show.
Shark.
I think I've been offered a run, but it was scale, which I literally like tilted my head like a dog who heard a sound that he didn't recognize. You know, like. I'm sorry, what? Scale, they were only offering scale, and it was the beginning of this thing. And later on, Heroes offered me like 20 shows for scale. And I'm not allowed to go off and do movies. You know, it's like, what's going on here?
Yeah.
And then at the same time I was offered this run on Shark, I got a call from a producer from this show that I did in Dublin. I'm mixing up my chronology. A show I did in New York, a little puppet show. And this producer guy was producing the All-Star Cup golf tournament, okay, which was a Ryder's Cup format, which is American celebrities against European celebrities. And other Americans were I think, Alice Cooper and Billy Baldwin and Chaz Parmentieri and Meatloaf,
sure,
who I became friends with from this. To play a tournament in Cardiff at the Celtic Manor, which I think the Ryder Cup is going to or just was at last. Anyway, and they were going to pay me because it was a 2-day TV presentation. So we're going to be on camera, more money than the 5 episodes of Shark.
Oh my goodness.
They were going to pay me more money than acting in 5 episodes
to play golf.
Come out and play golf.
And fly my family first class.
I think we're done.
This was, I think, the reason for the economic crash. And so I did it, and that's what led to the West End, because I came with my little reviews from you know, the New York Times and all that, from underneath the lintel, and I went and had 2 meetings in London because I was there.
Right.
And that's how my whole connection with London was started from golf.
Yeah, that's pretty fantastic.
But it beat out like more money to play golf than 5 episodes.
Thank God they didn't offer you your quote to do Shark. None of those other wonderful things would have happened.
Yeah, you would have had to just listen to James Woods talk about Mensa all day.
There's always a reason. There's always a reason.
MIT.
Is a Mensa guy?
He's Mensa, an MIT graduate. And a dear, dear friend. You two sons of bitches. It's time to ask you to explain the Larry King game and then ask you to do so that we can give you your exit visa. You'd spend a couple of hours with us, sir, whether you wanted to or not, and I'm extremely grateful.
Do I get a Larry King coffee cup? Because I got one of those.
Yeah, me too.
You do?
Yeah. Oh. Actually, but, you know what? I didn't save the cup, but I do remember getting
it. I saved it. No, I saved all of them.
You're a genius.
No, my wife was on Oprah, so she's got an Oprah cup. It's our cupboard. This is the awards are in closets somewhere,
right,
but
right.
the cups
you can use those.
So I want this. I'm not kidding.
I know you do.
You're not going to give me the cup?
We're going to give you the cup.
Yeah, I guess we'll give you the cup.
Yeah. Don't tell the others.
How many do you have? Like 2?
Don't tell the others.
Because
they sent us a case, and we gave them away, and then we got down to 6, and they said, we're not going to send you anymore.
Why?
Because they're dicks.
It's advertising.
Yeah, I know.
You know how many people are going to see this cup in my cupboard?
You know what? You're taking that one.
Okay.
Yeah, and you're the 7th guest that asked that all the other 6 were told
you said
no.
Really?
That's because you're my favorite. Just don't tell the others. So the Larry King game works like this. And by the way, he's launched a show now on Hulu, and apparently Seth MacFarlane was on the show and they talked about the Larry King game. So now he's aware. We didn't know whether
he was aware. When I tried to talk to Larry King about the Larry King game, he didn't want to have any of that.
Yeah, get away from me, kid. So we love making fun of Larry because it's so damn easy.
Jamie, our very own, created this game, and all the guests play at the end. It's a little improvised moment. Here's all I need from you. I'd like you to create that moment that Larry tells us a little something that we didn't need to know. And then he goes to the phones. It's like a little bumper before he goes to the phones. So the prototype that the guests and Jamie are annoyed by at this point, having watched and suffered through me giving this example, but I must, is this is the prototype of the things I want. A bad Larry King impression, a little bumper that Larry offers up about himself, too much information moment, and then go to the phone. If the name of the city is funny sounding, it's not going to be bad.
This is what I have to do?
This is what you'll have to do into that camera.
Can you give me a Larry King impression to start?
Here's the bad one I'm looking for. I don't want a good one. I want bad.
All I know is the shoulders.
That's it. You're halfway there.
I don't know how he's Brooklyn, right?
You're already there also. There's Brooklyn.
I don't know.
Yeah. That's the mumbling. You don't need the prototype. There's your camera. So you got the thing.
Des Moines.
Yeah. You got to give me a little King's things. A little something that Larry remembers or likes. And then throw it to any city you want. That's all you got to do.
Do I get any kind of setup?
No.
There's no question to respond to?
No, you're Larry.
So I got to give you some information about myself.
Into your camera.
I used to walk in the streets alone at night myself.
New Brunswick.
New Brunswick, New Jersey. A call.
That's all we ever ask. That's all we ever want.
Really?
Is to get inside the brain just for a nanosecond of the mush that is Larry King's brain.
I see him walking around the streets alone.
Well, that's what he does.
That's what came to my mind.
Right? Beverly Hills. He's always.
Beverly Hills.
He's always on his way to Nate Now's.
Oh, is
it
that
doesn't even matter if they're open.
Yeah.
He'll go by, look in the window. Yeah.
It's like the Stage Daily in New York where you look in the window and see the rats at night. You ever do that on 7th Avenue?
I don't call them the rats, but...
No, they got...
Oh, I thought you meant the tourists.
They got actual rats at night that come out on 7th Avenue. Good advertising.
That's fantastic. Why, we just lost that sponsor.
They're going to call a Richard Schiff sandwich now something really bad.
Yeah, a rat sleeve. Thank you very much.
It's my pleasure.
Honestly and truly.
Great time.
We're going to go see you on the Great White Way in December. When opening night, we're not sure yet of
November 11th.
November 11th, Glengarry.
Yeah.
Opening night. I'm so psyched. Have a great time with
And that. If I suck, you got Pacino and Cannavale, so
yeah,
I can't lose.
I don't see a bad version of this happening. Have a great time with it.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I'm gonna think about you when I'm.
When you turn up stage and giggle?
Yes.
Yeah. Please, remember that I said it's gonna be fine. Now you're alive.
No, I'm excited. Yeah. I'm going to go with that.
Okay. Anything I can do to help, I am a true fan, and thank you. Sit there uncomfortably for 60 seconds while I wrap things up and say goodbye to everybody.
I can do that.
Thanks to my guest, Richard Schiff, again. Go see him on Broadway or in the D.C. area with the play he does afterwards called Huey. Next week, we're off, and then the week after, we come back with great Phil Rosenthal, the creator of Everybody Loves Raymond, and just a wonderful writer and terrific fella.
And to prep for watching that show, check out Exporting Raymond.
It's on Netflix, I believe.
Netflix, HBO On Demand.
Yeah, he goes over to Russia and other places to sell.
It's to do a Russian version of Raymond. It's a really cool documentary.
Yeah. Yeah, that's a good idea. For everyone to go check it out.
Everyone
not just
out?
Me in preparation.
No, everyone should watch it. We'll come back, we'll talk about it.
Thanks to Jamie, Sammy, and Dr. Chen here in the studio. Out there we've got Justin, Josh, and Jason, the three J's of happiness. Elle sitting in on makeup as our own Samantha Ward was apparently working. Elaine, our social media expert. And Adam. Our intern was back one week and said, fuck it, I'm done with this.
He could not. He didn't put up with this shit.
He had it. He was reminded of a harsh reality that is the chat show. Tune in. Stay tuned. We're going to take a little time off in August, September for me to go to the Sweet Home, Alabama to do a little film. I'll tell you more about that when I get those dates locked in stone. And more about HollywoodPoker.com, which I'm unbelievably excited about. Sam, you're going to come to the house Wednesday for the little home game?
Come on.
All right. Until next time, and as always, get out of my face.